Hey everybody, Agent Jay Zulu on location in the outer reaches of the forbidden zone of our engine and equipment storage area. On what used to be, a few minutes ago, a sunny, beautiful late summer day, but now seems to be an autumn day with a bit of a storm coming in. Anyway, we're here looking at something rare, something that we don't usually work with or on, but sometimes. Okay, looks like a jet engine, doesn't it? Looks almost like a rocket engine, but it's not. We have here in this special area, actually in the box is a rotor from a different one, but we have three different power turbines. And the power turbine is something that, based on the questions I get, there is a great need for more explanation, because a lot of people are needing further information about how they work and why they're used. So let's take a closer look at some of these and what makes them very interesting. This one looking at you, this is not the exit of a jet engine. It sure looks like the exhaust nozzle of a jet engine where the gases go this way, doesn't it? But it's actually a power turbine where the gases go that way. So we're going to take a closer look at all three of these, and we're going to identify them and hopefully come up with the engines they work with. So hang on, we're going to move in. Okay, so it's quiet now, but we are right next to the airport, which is just over those trees, and so we will get the noise from the odd aircraft, possibly. Anyway, we're going to look at this one first. This is the most modern one. And we've got a diagram of this one in the shop. I'll show you in just a few minutes. This is a, what's it called? ELM116-2 power turbine made by Alstom. Now, when I worked at an Alstom plant, it didn't have an H in it. It was Alstom. But anyway, this is for the LM1600, which is the industrial version of the engine in the FA-18, the GEF-404. This is the inlet of the exhaust gases of the gas generator. Now we'll talk about gas generators versus jet engines a little bit more with the diagram. But this thing, I think it has two rotors in it, and the exhaust comes out here through that annulus or ring, and back here, this would be in a chamber outside the exhaust stream. The exhaust stream comes out there. This is the mechanical output shaft. Let's get a better view of it here. Trying not to get hung up on the other ones. So that's the mechanical output shaft, and that'll have about 20,000 horsepower coming out of it. And it probably won't turn. Oh, it does turn. Okay, so what that means is, I was going to talk about that in a second, but we'll get to it now. Some power turbines have ball bearings. I'm sure this one does. See that rotor in there moving away? So this has ball bearings a lot like an engine. And so it's gonna have, it's gonna start moving as soon as the gas generator or jet engine starts producing exhaust gases. Whereas other power turbines, I believe this one's for an Arenda, it will not turn. And that doesn't mean there's anything wrong with it. Just a second. So the Arenda power turbine takes the exhaust gases from an Arenda turbojet minus the nozzle, so technically it's a gas generator. We'll get to that as well. And it produces about 10,000 horsepower. Now, one of the things that I've been asked about before from people who actually work in power stations or in other capacities related to these things is they talk about a thing called breakaway speed. So this power turbine uses journal bearings or plane bearings. And the reason they do that is because a journal bearing, once running, there's no contact whatsoever. It's a fluid film bearing, and the wear occurs on startup and shutdown. So if your power turbine is gonna run continuously for years or decades or whatever, it wears less if it's a plane bearing. So a plane bearing, when it's not moving, it's literally pretty close to metal-to-metal contact. It's a very tight clearance. There may be some tiny, tiny fluid film there, but basically it's kind of stuck. It's sitting there. So what they call breakaway speed is the speed of the gas generator. If there's a jet here, and this is the direction of the exhaust gases going through it, the jet has to get up to a certain speed and power level before the gases rushing through the power turbine are producing enough torque on the turbine blades to get it to break away and start to move. Okay, now each power turbine that has a plane bearing will have a different breakaway speed. And the breakaway speed, when they say speed, breakaway is from zero, obviously, for the power turbine. So the breakaway speed is the gas generator upstream feeding it the gases. So in a nutshell, we'll do it right here. If you take a turbojet engine, it has behind the turbine and in the jet pipe, whether it's an afterburner or not, it has gas at around 20 to 30 PSI and a fairly high velocity. When it reaches the exhaust nozzle at the end, it's going to taper down. And what that's going to do, it's going to reduce the pressure to as close to ambient as possible, but massively increase the speed as much as possible. And that's where you get the thrust from. So the thrust of the turbojet engine is mostly created by that nozzle at the very end squeezing down and causing, by the Bernoulli principle, the pressure does not go up, it goes down, and the speed increases hugely, and that increase in speed causes the jet to move forward. Now, if you take that nozzle off, you've got that 20 to 30 PSI of high velocity air. It's got a huge amount of energy. We're not going to turn it into speed with the exhaust nozzle. We're going to turn it into rotational force with the rotors of a power turbine. So when you take the nozzle off of a turbojet engine, you have a straight pathway coming out the back. It's now technically called a gas generator. It's the nozzle that makes it an engine, or a jet engine. Okay, so this is the Arenda. Very cool, very heavily built, you see that? This is the one that was in the skid that was right over there that I made a video on called Retired PT Skid, I believe, a couple years ago. So let's take a look at this one here. This one's really cool because we can look up inside it and see, those are not turbine blades, those are the inlet stators or inlet guide vanes for the turbine. So even though this looks like an exhaust cone for a jet engine, it's an inlet fairing for the first stage turbine stators, which are forward of the turbine blades. So that gives you a little bit of a hint that we're dealing with a different kind of machine here, because in the jet engine, the turbine inlet guide vanes, of course, are in front of the turbine blades and force the gases at the right angle on the turbine blades to maximize the turning of the turbine. So here, if this was a jet engine, if it was, which it isn't, then the stators would be on this side of the turbine blades. But in this thing, this is a power turbine, the gases go in there and out that way, and they turn the turbine. So the vanes are in front of the turbine. It's all seems so weird. But that's the cool thing. Okay, let's take a look at the structure of this thing. It's quite interesting. Okay, you can see some torch marks here. This is the exhaust duct, has been cut away. And the other, there's this cone and this cone would both form the exhaust duct. Now this may have been in an installation where they wanted to get it out quickly. A lot of times power plants get decommissioned and these are still good. So you bid on them, you get them, but you gotta get them out of there, and they just want them gone. So it's been sliced out. There's a sheet of metal about 1/4 inch thick here, would have come out. And then the inner one is a little bit less than that, maybe 3/16, and it comes out. They would have formed a giant exhaust annulus. And this frame here is outside the exhaust. So this would be deep inside a hole, difficult to get to, but it's where the bearings are contained. And it's outside the exhaust stream. So the exhaust duct here is really, it's gone. It's been cut away. Let's take a look at the back. So I apologize if there's a lot of wind noise. It's just the way things are. I've got extra protection on the microphone to hopefully prevent too much battering. But this frame here would have been bolted to the wall, the installation, a ship, if it was in a ship. I don't think it was. But this is the output shaft. And it's not going to turn. because this is also a plane bearing or a journal bearing power turbine. So we can identify this one. It says RT45. RT45 is a type of gas turbine or power turbine, sorry, power turbine used with the Rolls-Royce Avon, and I think it can also work with the LM1500. Anyway, a great thick hulking piece of machinery. You can take a look at the thickness. Okay, let's look at that. There's my hand, and that's got to be I don't know, inch and a half thick steel. And there would have been access to these connections. That's why this thing is cast that way. It's very heavily built. Very cool. And this would be roughly a 15 to 20,000 horsepower unit. So 15 to 20,000, 10,000 horse, and 20,000. Now this one is lighter and more modern, and it's got the ball bearings. So you could say it's a bit more sophisticated. Very cool. It actually has a date of manufacture on it. I think we saw that before, but I didn't point it out. Let's see, date of manufacture, 1994. Very cool. So, and it seems a bit more lightly built. Don't know why. Maybe it is for a ship to avoid weighing a lot more. There's a torque link down there, that torque arm. Look at that, you Honda Civic guys. That's a torque link for this power turbine, because the other ones would connect right here where the stand does. This stand is nowhere near beefy enough to handle the torque of this thing. So you've got the, if the shaft is turning, let's say, which way would it turn? It would turn clockwise from our point of view here, clockwise aft looking forward. So the case of this thing by the stators, the stators are producing a massive torque on the rotor. If the torque is going clockwise, then the case would want to go counterclockwise. And that's what the torque links are for. I think there'd be three or probably four of them in the installation. And those are amazing things. Those are machined high tensile steel, immensely strong. I don't know the torque of this power turbine, but I do know the torque of a larger one. Oh, we have one. Oh, we do. Let's go take a look at the 2500. Hang on, folks. We got some excitement. Oh, yeah. All right, so there it is. I've had to uncover it. There was a tarp on it. I've showed this before in previous videos years ago. That is the power turbine from an LM2500. Which is roughly a 35,000 horsepower engine, roughly, something like that. Newer versions produce more. So, we're going to take a look at the mechanical output shaft. We just kind of took a look quickly at the inlet, the gas inlet. This one, there's the mechanical output shaft. Now, take a look at the size. There's a lot of them, but this is the size of the bolts. Those would be 5/16 bolts, so reasonable, but not huge. There's a lot of bolt holes, though. This is the mechanical output flange. And that thing has a continuous output torque of 66,000 foot-pounds. 66,000 foot-pounds, that's something. That is really something. Awesome. All right, so power turbines, they are technically called power turbines on aircraft engines that are turbofans and turboprops. Sometimes you can call them the LP turbine, but it is a power turbine, a free power turbine, especially in a turboprop. But anyway, the big ones like this, these are on larger engines than are running as turboprops. I think the most powerful turboprops are 10,000 horse, so they'd be roughly about this capacity, although this one is much more heavily built than an aircraft engine. It's not meant to go anywhere. But power turbines are kind of a rare beast. You don't see them very often. You don't see them in operation. They're deep hidden away in power plants. And there's much larger ones working with steam. But this is cool. We've got three here and one over there, different power turbines in the same location. So that's very cool. And this ties into a video that I made quite a while ago called Stationary Engine, No Power. So I want to reopen, I want to rip the Band-Aid off that wound and reopen the discussion. Because the engine that is attached to any one of these power turbines is literally bolted to a fixture set in concrete. It doesn't move a millimeter. Yet it produces 20,000, 15,000, or 10,000 horsepower. So you got the engine sitting there, burning fuel, making huge amounts of noise and blasting gas out the back, and you're going to tell me it's making no power. And then you stick one of these in that gas path without changing anything, nothing. Now it's making 20,000 horsepower. Where'd the power come from? Magic? So you say, oh, we meant useful power. Well, what does useful mean? Useful is a subjective word. Is it useful to you? Useful to me? What if I want to blow a bunch of air? I want a giant fan or a giant high pressure, high speed velocity jet of hot gas. Well, then it's very useful power. And you say, well, we meant mechanical power. Well, what's mechanical? If you're making a ship move through the water, well, that's mechanical power. Okay. What if you're making an airplane move through the air? Well, that's mechanical power. What if you're making a tank roll across the sand with 1,500 horsepower, a power turbine? Oh, that's mechanical horsepower. But a molecule of air going from 0 to 1,000 kilometers an hour, a molecule of air is a thing. It's a mechanical thing. There's just lots of them. If you look in physics classes and physics books, mechanics doesn't say, oh, only things above this size, only bigger things, only stuff you can see. Don't be ridiculous. These are examples that prove that a stationary gas generator, jet engine, turbine engine, stationary, literally bolted to concrete, makes massive amounts of power when it's running. So to ignore the air because you can't see it is something a toddler would do. Are you a toddler? Anyway, this is H&J Zulu, once again, on location, in the wind, for you to see the stuff you need to see and the stuff I work with. This is awesome. Power turbines, RT45, OTF3, and what did we call this one? What is it? Oh, it's an ELM 116/2. ELM 116/2. They got to work on their marketing, come up with a better name. And remember, any of you engineering students out there, or wannabe engineering students, or people just interested. These are called power turbines because they extract power. Power turbines because they extract power out of the gas stream of a stationary jet engine. So you extract power from something that doesn't have any power? No. You extract the power that is there, you turn it from kinetic energy into rotational mechanical power. Kinetic energy streaming in a straight line with high velocity, high masses of gas is mechanical power. It's a thing being moved. But anyway, power turbines for extracting power from the exhaust gases of a stationary gas generator, a stationary turbine engine, a stationary jet engine. Definitely makes power. I think I've beaten that one to death now, haven't I? Yes. Now look what I found pinned to the wall of the shop. This is a diagram of a power turbine with a gas generator. Now you're not going to hear me say this very often on this channel, but don't pay any attention to the engine. It doesn't really matter what it is. Although it's a two-spool something, I'm not sure what it is. Could be a spay. I don't know. But this is the gas flow coming out of the engine into the power turbine, running the great big huge shaft. And these look like ball bearings, but that looks like a journal bearing. I'm not sure what the arrangement is. And the exhaust gases get dumped into this giant plenum, which is like a donut around the engine, and they go up a giant smokestack. So this is a jet engine and all the mounting, and look how much thicker and beefier all this stuff is. That's heavy metal. Heavy metal power generation. Very cool. I'm sure if you looked up this name on the internet, on the Google thing, you would find more information. I may do that when I get home. But this is an excellent example of how you take a stationary jet engine and make it produce huge amounts of power with a power turbine. Yeah, awesome. Sorry about the wind noise, people, but it's a very windy day. I think a storm's coming. Anyway, the boys have been rearranging the storage yard, and this is a very rare opportunity because what we have is an Arenda, I think it's a Type 9, but an Arenda aircraft turbojet and two Arenda gas generators for use with power turbines. And we're gonna go around the back and take a look at the difference in the way that they're arranged. There's no exhaust nozzle on these two. But also I want you to pay attention to the external equipment, how much there is on the turbojet and how little there is in the industrial engine. Very interesting. Okay, now I know it's coated with plastic, but hopefully you can see that there's basically a flat surface here that gets joined to a tube, a short tube to the power turbine. And here, this actual surface here is right here on the turbojet. And you can see this tapering down, which leads to the jet pipe, which then leads to the exhaust nozzle, which is even smaller. So these produce a raging stream of gases. This produces a raging stream of gases that's tapered down and accelerated out a nozzle to create a jet of gases, which is why it's called a jet engine. Cool. It's actually starting to rain now. It was a beautiful summer day just a few minutes ago. Anyway, this is cool. You don't often see the two side by side. And now we'll take a quick look at the externals of the front to see the accessories. Okay, these are industrial gas generators. There's an igniter box and a few oil lines, not much else. There's an oil tank on that one. The igniter box, a few oil lines and fuel lines. These are actually, this one's a liquid fueled. They're both liquid fueled gas generators. Very cool. And this is a liquid fueled aircraft engine. It has the fuel pumps on top, which are missing on the industrial engines. There's a few more things. This is a fuel control. The fuel control is not on the industrial engines either. Oil tanks in a different place. The accessory drive. This is used to drive the fuel pumps, and beneath it is the oil pump. So on the industrial engines, the oil pump is also there. There's an oil pump on the aircraft engine and the industrial engine. But the accessory drive goes to basically speed pickups and nothing else. Interesting. Got the inlet fairings there. Those are actually aircraft inlet fairings. Very nice. This one would have one as well, but it's also got the inlet debris screen, which was discovered to be unnecessary after a few years of operation. So most all engines don't have these. We've talked about that before. Yeah, very cool. Oh, and you see what's missing here is the cover, and the covers often often evaporated because to some people, they were quite attractive. This one's intact. It's unusual to see that on an industrial engine. A lot of times they're less glamorous, like that one. But anyway, very, very interesting. You don't often get the opportunity to see the industrial and aircraft versions side by side. That is just, I feel lucky. Do you feel lucky? Do you feel lucky, punk? Well, do ya? All right. Okay, we've had the field trip. Now it's time to get back to the homework in the lab. And we're gonna back up a little bit because I could back up forever, but hey, we'll start here. This is the LM1600, which is the industrial version of the F404. Freeze and read at your leisure. I'll try not to bang the tripod. Latest edition of General Electric's fleet of marine industrial gas generators, 88. An aeroderivative of GE's highly successful F404 jet aircraft engine. The LM1600 was designed to be an easy-to-maintain, user-friendly gas generator. Blah. Okay. Now, what are we looking at? The next page I want to see is, this is general information for when you're running your LM1600 in your 20,000 horsepower yacht. Weight, Was it 20,000 horsepower or was it, I think it says right here, let's be honest with our customers, 19,000 isentropic horsepower, which probably means 16,000 or so available at the prop. The reason it does that with only 99 pounds per second versus 150 pounds per second for the LM1500 is because it's 22-to-1 compression ratio or compressor ratio, engine pressure ratio, whereas with the LM1500 using 1.5 times the air and making less power is because it has about a 10-to-1. Okay. So now I'm going to move to somewhere else. Oh, this here. This is all your user parameters for your... I'm assuming you've got two of these in your yacht, sir. Okay. LM1600 training guide. Right up to date. You betcha. Basic engine introduction. This is the part of every manual that is so interesting. It's quite thick. See that? All that stuff. It is just a general description of what the thing is and how it's built. Yada, yada. I'm sure none of you are interested in this stuff. But we can't back up forever. We can't back up forever. That's what I must say. So, got some cool diagrams. Combustors, modules, compressor. Where was a good one? There was a good one somewhere. Well, anyway, we've got lots of good ones. So we're going to jump way ahead to the ELM116/2 power turbine. I think we just looked at one of those things. The power turbine extracts power from the gas generator exhaust gases, extracts power to turn a two-stage power turbine rotor. The rotor provides direct drive to a gas compression pump, a reduction gearbox, an electrical generator, or some other piece of driven equipment. Yes, like maybe the propeller of a ship. Okay, now we need to jump forward to what it looks like. Where is that? Where are those diagrams? There's an overall view with the exhaust duct there. We didn't see that. And I'll show you a picture that will make you recognize what we were looking at. Soon, I promise. Oh, power turbine rotor assembly. It says front roller bearing location and aft ball bearing location. So it did have roller bearings, but that was obvious by the way it turned with minimal effort. Yeah, we're coming up to the picture. There we go. Looks like one, right? That looks like what we were looking at in a basic line drawing thing. There we go. So this is the airflow, the blue stuff, through the power turbine. Stator blade, so stationary stator, rotor blade, stationary stator, rotor blade. These are the two discs on the shaft that turn the massively torquey output shaft. And this is the gas flow into the massively diffusing exhaust stack, and the reason it expands so much is to reduce the noise and the velocity of the flow. And you'll find that in a ship or in an installation powered by one of these things, the exhaust is the whole thing's virtually silent because so much space is devoted to silencing of both the inlet and the output, the exhaust. Balanced piston air. This orange stuff, it's pushing against the back of the discs to help reduce the load, the this way load on the ball bearings. There's a ball bearing, the thrust bearings, because there's a huge amount of push against the turbine. So let's push back and reduce the load on that bearing. It increases the life of this bearing. Very good. Okay, so I think that's our LM1600 power turbine diagram. And there's another diagram from this book that's very nice. It shows the whole thing, but it's got no colors. There's the inlet to the engine, front frame IGVs. There's the gas path narrows down even more to this little tiny bit. Goes into the combustor, rages the gas out through the high pressure turbine right there, which powers the HP spool, and the low pressure turbine, which has two, does it have two? I think it has two stages, which powers the low pressure compressor. Then what's left over? What's left over from all that power extraction goes through this transition duct into the PT that we just saw in color. Power turbine output. Power turbine. So that's the overall arrangement. Very cool. And the next design, or not design, diagram we have is from the other guys. Hey, look at that. There's an Arenda gas generator. It looks like an Arenda 9 turbojet, possibly a 10. Anyway, they've got this thing called a power takeoff, with a lot of people mistaken that as where that's where the power goes. No, it's technically a power takeoff, like a farm implement. It takes a portion of the engine's power to drive certain mechanical accessories, which are not illustrated here. Well, actually, this is an industrial engine, so yeah, there's a speed pickup there and nothing much else. There's an oil pump, so those are driven off the power takeoff. This whole thing compresses the air, gets burnt in there. There's a two-stage gas producer turbine, so that means it is an Arenda 14 design, basically. It's got the two stages. The power turbine stator assembly, and the first thing you can see on the inlet to the power turbine, and the power turbine rotor. It's hard to see because it's a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy, but this is the power turbine. They don't have it divided in segments like GE did, but this is the gas generator is from here forward, and the power turbine is from there backwards. And you can see that there's actually no duct between the two. There's a very short, they're basically bolted right together. This, I have seen this arrangement, this exact arrangement, with about, oh, let's see, 50 to 100 feet of tubing going from here to there, because the power turbine was at a much higher elevation and it was in the middle of a giant rotating assembly for a wind tunnel. Anyway, this is a nice short coupling, and your exhaust duct comes out the back. They've got these turning vanes in there, the vaned exhaust elbow. The vanes must be to help reduce turbulence and therefore noise on the output of the exhaust. But you've got your output shaft. So we saw all this in the field. It's very cool. And remember, now that we've seen the diagram, remember, if you want to watch one of these, the gas generator, the aircraft version being built for a Sabre jet, and make sure you take a look at Agent J Zulu, spelt just like this, spelt just like that. You want to go to patreon.com/AgentJZulu. Agent J's, Agent JZ, possibly. But I like Zulu, Agent J Zulu. Go there, and you can see now there's 34 videos. There's more being added all the time. Okay, that's the latest in a series of videos I've made over the years on power turbines. I hope that I've helped to explain something about how they work. And we will know if I've succeeded by the general content and what's the general gist, the general slope, the general slant, the general way of thinking we see in the questions that are about to come up. From central Canada, not central this way, central this way. We're on the west coast, almost the west coast, the most westerly province, midway up in Canada. Agent J Zulu on location. Thanks for watching.